Selfie mode on. This is Ham Radio Now, episode 322, part two. Not Durham Hamfest. I'm at the Durham Hamfest. No, this is the Dayton Hamvention Friday. Ham Radio Now and the Phasing Lines coverage of the Dayton Hamvention and Xenia on Friday, part two. But today I am at the Durham, North Carolina Hamfest. So I've gone from the largest hamfest in the world, arguably, something about Japan, I'm not sure, to, well, okay, this isn't the smallest, but it's a little tailgater. But they do have one thing that the Dayton Hamvention did not have this year, and that is a paved parking lot for the flea market right there behind me. And the indoor space is air conditioned. Okay, let's leave Durham, head back to Xenia, Ohio, and check out the rest of the Dayton Hamvention. And Marty will be back. So I'm looking at this new 6400. This is brand new at the show, right?
That's right. We announced it today. Actually, four new models today.
All right. So looking at the front panel of that radio, it appears that Flex has completely capitulated to the Real Radios Have Knobs crew.
Well, I would say that we've capitulated to have it your way. You can have knobs, you can have no knobs, you can have an iPad, an iPhone, a Mac, a PC, or you can have it all integrated in one box.
Okay, but the knobs turned out to be maybe a bigger deal than you initially thought it would be?
Well, for some people, yes. It depends on how you operate. If you're a contester or working in a de-expedition, the knobs may work better for you. If you're a digital operator doing all digital modes, the PC only may be a better solution for you.
So you can do it no matter how somebody wants to do it. What's new with this radio besides the front panel?
Well, we've done a couple of things. We've taken the economies of scale and we've given you a high performance radio for under $2,000 now. And you can have it integrated in the 6400 with the front panel for under $3,000. This is $29.99. It has the highest performance display of any radio ever made. This is a 1920 by 1200 resolution IPS touch display, 8-inch on the front panel. And then we have an HDMI output that you can see back here that gives you 1920 by 1200 on an HD TV as well.
So is this radio spec-wise and feature-wise closer to one of the other radios than the other?
Well, the 6400 is going to be higher performance than the 6300, and the 6600 is going to be higher performance than the 6500. The 6600 will be higher than the 6500. The 6600 has dual SCUs, which means you can have two antennas, full duplex simultaneously. And for a contester, you can work SO2R, or if you want to have a 6 meter antenna on one port and a tri-band or another port, you can do that with the 6600. It also has contest grade filters on all of the contest bands for increased isolation. Band-to-band isolation is on the 6600.
I guess to really well illustrate a line that you guys have been able to cross, I understand that the Bouvet de-expedition is going to use all Flex radios?
Right. They're taking a dozen Flex radios and a dozen of our new Power Genius amplifiers. So they're planning to have 10 stations on the air at all times, including moon bounce stations. They'll all be Flex radio. So that's coming up early next year.
Yeah, now how did you get them to do that, or did they come to you?
They came to us. Several of the people on that de-expedition are Flex radio customers already. A couple of them have taken them on de-expeditions and found that they changed the way they could operate, especially on the low bands. They were able to see signals before they could hear them and simply double-click on the Maestro screen and on 160 meters, for example. They could see signals below 10 dB below the noise, and they were working signals they never knew were there on other radios.
So it took the Maestro to get them over that hump.
Took them over that hump, that's correct.
All right. I've asked another prominent radio manufacturer how long it's going to be until all radios are SDR, and it's not a feature, and he said, pretty soon.
It's the one other major manufacturer making an SDR radio now. So how are you guys going to compete?
Well, take a look. We think we're well ahead. We're the only manufacturer that has a radio server. In other words, the radio is a multi-user server that can operate with a whole host of client devices. One of my customers came in this morning and he said that he was demonstrating 2200 meters to 24 gigahertz all automatically switched off of his Flex 6000 on a Microsoft Surface, all completely controlled over his cellular network as if he were sitting at his station. Try that with any other radio.
Yep. So are these radios available, or when are they coming out?
So these will be shipping in the July-August timeframe. The ones with the front panel and knobs will be July-August, and a couple of months later for the one without the front panel. We offer it both ways.
In addition to finding the folks who want to operate with knobs, you're also looking at dropping one notch in price to a lower tier?
Yeah, we've been able to take advantage of our economies of scale and get the cost down across the models, all the models now, so it's a lower entry price for and increased performance in these new radios.
Is that going to keep on going? Is there a cost factor where things keep ratcheting down?
Well, I think with volumes, we see that capability. We're able to take advantage of combining our larger volumes across multiple products, and so taking advantage of that, newer components help that too.
I don't know what, speaking of volume, what the total volumes of any of these manufacturers are, but are we past the point where we should be talking about the big three? Should it be big four?
I think it already is.
or is it big three, but a different three?
Different three. Different three, I think, probably. We think that we have been able to change the conversation in the ham radio market. In 2003, when we started, maybe 10% of the people knew what SDR was, and now most everybody's heard of it.
Go ahead. Well, you would agree everyone's going to be SDR sooner or later, or they'll be gone.
Yeah, in fact, I have a slide that says Superhit SK on 1918 to 2017. So I think this is the year that everything turned. So we think that direct sampling SDRs are the present and the future. Not only that, is that we're true SDR, in other words, with a big S on the S, because we do constant software development. And so the radio doesn't stay stagnant. We're coming out with version 2 soon, which has plug and play remote with all these devices that I mentioned, and we're demonstrating that here in the booth.
So you're calling the RF components the radio server. Do they need to get upgraded now and then?
Well, it depends on your application. For many people, what they have today, even the 6000s that have been in the market, have been shipped 4 or 5 years ago, will get advantage of the latest technology software. So they will actually get effectively a new radio with the latest software release. That's a new paradigm to be able to do that.
And there is a big area of amateur radio that you guys don't get into very much, and that is the VHF digital voice modes. You can get VHF stuff, transverters, and work your way up with Flex as the base radios, but not as a handheld, not as a mobile radio, you can do some of the digital modes by using the codecs like D-Star and Codec 2, but is that going to be a big place for you sometime in the future? Or are we going to be competing for the DMR market for the handhelds and mobiles?
Well, I can't comment on future development. I will say that we do have the ability to run D-Star on these radios. You can plug in the USB dongle, and D-Star pops up on the front panel. And
free DV codec, too.
And free DV, too. So they pop up as modes. And so I'm sure we'll continue to enhance those modes over time, but I don't have specifics on what we might do in other areas.
Okay. We also have to redefine the term multi-mode radio, don't we?
Yeah, that's really true, because in our environment, a developer can actually add a mode to our radio. We've developed an open API for waveforms as well as controlling our radios, so that a developer could go actually add a new digital mode without our help and add it in as a mode that would pop up on the radio.
How is that API thing going? It had a slow start, right?
It's not slow anymore. We have over 150 developers, And some of those, one of the examples of that is the iPad and iPhone app, the iOS app. Marcus Roshkosh from Germany developed that on his own and approached us, and we decided to partner together. He completely independently developed it using our API and has continued to add to it. So there's a good example. We have multiple loggers that now are talking directly directly to our application without the use of CAT.
Do the application developers need help from you at any point? Do you see applications that are developed that you'd rather they did a little bit more work on them?
Well, it ranges from everything from somebody that's just playing for their own educational enjoyment, and that's fine, a ham that wants to do something, all the way to we have commercial entities. We have a Flex 6700 on the International Space Station, actually two of them, and the developer there was a system integrator, and they developed completely to our API.
And it's not a ham radio.
It's not a ham radio, but it shows you the spectrum. And in between, you have people that have actually developed applications and are charging for them. The iOS app is a commercial application sold on the Apple Store for $39. And you can go purchase it today. And he developed that independently, and he gets the revenue. We actually support it. And the Dog Park has the Mac Logger. The guy who developed Mac Logger has developed a user interface for our radio on the Mac that's native. And so he sells that application. So you have commercial developers now selling applications.
But if a developer is having trouble getting something done, can you give them a boost?
Yes, we can. All the time we support developers. They have questions. We have an online community where all our developers communicate with one another. In fact, some of them have even written documentations and how-to, and they provided source code for some of the work they've done. So there's a user community that's also supporting one another in addition to our team. And we monitor that channel and provide support on there as well.
Now, those programs aren't required to be open source or anything, are they?
No, they can do it however they want. They can make it close. For example, the Mac program, the Dog Part SDR, is closed source. And so is the iOS application.
Yeah, and your API isn't technically open source. It's just
It's an open API. Now, we actually provide the source to our Windows API. So we've had developers that have ported that over to other platforms. But you can do virtually everything that I can do here. You can do it through that API.
All right. Anything else I'm missing?
Well, we've also introduced a new amplifier that's completely integrated, a 2-kilowatt amplifier completely integrated over Ethernet.
Yeah, I made a deal with Tim Ellison. I talked to him about that at Orlando, and then he tried to talk to me about the future of SDR. It was a good show.
Yes, and I think you should take a look as well and talk to our engineers about the new remote software. We're demoing running off of Maestro and PCs to about 15 stations that are our customers all over the US, and I think even one or two in Europe that are set up so you can just instantly log in to those stations.
Remote's come a long way.
It is, and we've taken a long way with this new release because you don't have to have any external boxes, you don't need VPNs. You basically set it up, you tell the radio to register, and you push the push to talk button, and that says, I'm really at this real radio. And you can set up your login and password. You can even use social connections like Google or Facebook to log in to your radio. So those are options. And it's very easy to set up. We have a cloud server that does the connection. Once you're connected, then you're peer-to-peer with your radio. No VPN, no special setup.
So the cloud lets go and you go direct to your radio?
Yeah, the cloud just arbitrates to connect you with your radio.
All right, one last question. We're at a totally new venue for the Dayton Hamvention. What impressions have you made so far?
Well, it's warm.
Yeah, we're both sweating pretty well.
Yeah, we're sweating pretty well. So this is a lot like Orlando as far as the building is.
Minus the air conditioning in Orlando.
Minus the air conditioning. It's a little cooler in February in Orlando or January. I would say we've been treated very well here. The staff has worked really hard to set us up. We've been totally swamped all day, so that's a good thing.
So it looks like the ham traffic is good.
The ham traffic's been great in here, so that's been good. Wish it were cooler. That's my...
And that's about it. You probably got in early enough to not get caught in traffic.
We were early, but there was still a lot of traffic. It was a little bit hard for us to find how to get into vendor parking, too.
Oh, did you know about Gate 6?
No.
I'll tell you about that off the air. All right, Gerald, thank you very much.
All right, thank you.
Well, I'm not exactly sure which one of the big three that Gerald thinks Flex has replaced, but I know it's not ICOM. I think they're still sitting on top. But you other guys, which one is no longer number three? Okay, come on into my TV show.
Good morning.
It's been a while since I've had you on Ham Radio Now.
And it is Friday morning, and we're inside the exhibit hall before things have opened up, and I'm talking to Scott from ICOM. Scott, what have you got that's secret that's going to be unveiled this year that you can give me a sneak peek of?
That's very true. Yeah, it's been a
while. So welcome back. We've got new radio.
Yes, well, newer than new radio. It's not even out yet. This is a prototype that came straight from Japan to the show.
Everybody was wondering if it would be here, so it's here.
Well, we were wondering ourselves, but it made it. Actually, we had a couple days to play with it. Today was the first time we actually got an antenna hooked to it. We've been exploring the menus because, of course, it came with no documentation or anything. So we've been learning a lot of things about it ourselves.
At least the menus are in English.
That's true. It's still a Japanese model. It had a couple odd features I didn't recognize from a Japanese radio. But
what have you found? This is SDR.
It is a true SDR. It's a dual receive. You can see we have two receivers here. They can both be active. I have a primary VFO there that I can tune. We brought in a number of people had commented online. We heard that that there's only a single VFO knob. So you can, of course, use the main and sub button normally to switch between the two. But it turns out we discovered a feature in the radio that works with our RC28 controller here. And it will actually operate in real time that sub VFO. So you can actually have a second VFO knob.
So problem solved.
Exactly. There's a number of things. You can actually have dual spectrum scopes, dual waterfalls. I turned off the waterfall, sorry. I was messing around. But you can do dual spectrum scopes, dual waterfalls.
Or one of each, I suppose.
Or one big one if you choose, right. And you can actually have the two different VFOs here are on, you know, can be on two different bands. It's true dual receive. There's two volume controls. You can actually mute either of the bands, and it just goes amber, so you can, if you want to shut one of them up briefly, you can do that. They have separate gain controls, separate filter selections, separate modes, all that stuff.
Not a touchscreen.
It is a touchscreen, actually.
It is.
Absolutely, yeah. So we can go to CW mode here if we like, or let's switch it over to 80 meter. Well, let's go to 10 meters. How about that? So there's 10 meters.
Now, is this one of those things where you can see a signal and touch it and go to it?
You can. So you can touch on the screen. You also have, now that we've added, from the 7300, they've added the two USB ports here in the front. I just unplugged the mouse because it's kind of a rat's nest. I didn't have a nice wireless one to bring. We can plug in a mouse, and if you want, you can have a little more accurate clicking than the big fat tip of your finger. When you click on a signal, let's go back to 20 meters here. If you want to click on a signal, it blows it up a little bit, and then you can tap it again, and it'll tune right to the center of that frequency.
And what modes is it capable of?
This one actually does, AM, FM, sideband. It also has CW. In fact, let me bring up the screen here. It will do both RIDI and PSK decode in the radio, and you can plug a keyboard into one of those USB ports, and you have all the keyer functions across F1 through 8, and then you can type full responses and decode right on the screen.
Okay, so that shows up as text on the screen.
Absolutely, yeah. It's got a little RIDI decode screen. It's a nice big screen, so it's got a reasonable amount of text on the screen.
It's getting windy in here.
We've got a storm headed our way, exactly.
So where does this fall in the pantheon of the ICOM radios in price and availability?
So we're expecting to see the radio this fall, we expect it to be about the same price that the 7600 when it was introduced, which would be about in the $3,500 price range. We'll see once it's not, hasn't been FCC type accepted or anything at this point. So once that happens, we'll have
not available for sale.
Not available. Yeah, this one here is priceless.
So look over there, aliens.
No, it has a bodyguard 24/7.
I don't see anybody handcuffed to it, but it's close.
It's been getting mauled pretty well today, actually. So, yeah, we've got had a lot of interest, actually. This is the first time you've been able to actually stand around the thing all day long. You've made good
My timing was good. So have you had a chance to play with it on the air, make contacts and stuff?
No, we don't have an antenna. What we have in here is a signal source that lets us play with the signals on the receiver. But, yeah, if I transmit, that would be bad. So, yeah, it's unfortunate. The new venue actually gives us some opportunities. Maybe next year we'll have a real antenna. But in the past, that's been really complicated to manage.
Okay, so I've been asking everybody about the venue, pluses, minuses, a couple of, you know, give me the big one or two on the plus and minus side.
Well, we've actually had a pretty good time getting in here. We're able to get good access. So we've got a nice square booth. It's really easy. The venue's nice and clean.
I was just over at the Flex booth. I was sweating like a dog. You have a crosswind going through here that's really nice.
We ordered that up special. It's going to get really windy here soon. We had things flying around the booth while we were setting up, actually.
My phone went off with an alert. There might be a thunderstorm coming by.
Yeah, I was just looking at a radar map. It looks pretty bad. We'll be
fine. It's coming right at us?
It looks like it's headed our way, yeah.
Okay, so we've been really lucky all day, but that can't hold out.
It looks like we may have. Well, I'm inside, so it's all fine. I like the breeze personally, but
you have to close these windows, yeah. These doors.
We may have to roll the doors down, yeah. So it's been good access, though. We've got lots of space. The hallways don't seem as crowded. It's spread out a little more. We spread the booth out a little more than we have in the past to get better traffic flow through here.
Totally redesigned booth.
Yeah, absolutely. In the past, we've had those cabinets, which are nice and easy to set up, but it makes some choke points, and this gets people spread out a little more.
All right. Is there any minuses?
Not that we've seen so far. I mean, other than we had some expectations, we hadn't been to the venue before, so it's like, oh, you know, the power was hanging from the ceiling and not on the floor. It's like, that wasn't in the plan, right?
But you got by.
Oh, yeah, we went and bought some extension cords. We're all good. It worked out great. So,
all right. I ask ordinary attendees if they're going to come next year. That's the real big question. Now, of course, you guys are coming next year.
Well, absolutely, yeah. I think we'll be a little better prepared next year, and we'll see what the... We'll do a little after action, right? A little post-mortem after the event and see what changes. But overall, I think it's been going really well.
So it's been a learning experience for you and the HERA committee.
Oh, yeah. Well,
not HERA committee, the DERA committee.
DERA committee. I think I'm sure they're going to do exactly the same thing. And this year was a learning experience for everybody. So I'm sure it'll be even better next year.
And hopefully they'll talk to you and the other vendors and say, what was your experience? They want feedback.
They generally don't have to ask to get feedback. Although they have actually already been by and asked if we've been having any issues. So they've been really good about that.
All right. Thank you very much, Scott.
Thank you.
Come here and get in on my own show.
Yeah, very cool. Good.
Look who I ran into, just walking through the parking lot.
Hi, folks. Ward Silver N0AX at the Hamvention.
Yeah, and I thought I'd ask you what your impression is so far. It's Friday afternoon now. There's a thunderstorm about to hit, so your impression's going to change in about 20 minutes.
That's okay, but I'll be cleaner when it does. So, yeah, it's been fun, you know, learning about the new facilities, where everything is. You know, I had HERA all memorized, and now I have to start all over
again. It's like buying a new radio.
Oh, yeah, you know, buy a new radio. It'll take your mind off things.
Yeah, well, I mean, you buy a new radio, especially a band you haven't been spending much time on, and learning all how it works. It's cool.
I'm getting ready to set up a big portable satellite station with a couple of FT-817s, and then I'm going to do some pan adapter stuff with them in my copious free time, maybe later this summer. So that's the plan, and I'm having a good time. I'm going to sign some of my books and meet and greet. I think Dara's done a really good job moving that whole giant Hamvention that's run on, you know, steam and autopilot for the last 40 years, and now they had to pick it up and bring it all over here. And traffic is tough. I gotta say, traffic is tough. They'll have a better plan next year, and I think everybody's really happy with it.
They may have a better plan tomorrow. I was talking to N8VES, and he says they're talking about maybe they can do something with one-way traffic out there on Saturday, so we'll see. But that has been the number one complaint from everybody that I've talked to, and of course, not much air conditioning anywhere except the forum rooms.
Well, that means attendance was good, doesn't it? Yeah, so, you know, attendance is up from last year, I think. And doing some one-way stuff, that'd be fine if the police can, you know, figure out how to do it. Express lanes in and out of the Hamvention. Who would have thought? So, it's going to work.
So traffic is your biggest minus?
Oh, yeah. I mean, So I sweat. Big deal. I'm fine. You know,
it's a ham fest.
It's a ham fest. I mean, we're hams. This is what we do. So this is great.
This is not the NAB.
No. And, you know, it's a federal rule that we have to have sideways rain during Hamvention at least once.
Got a feeling we're going to get it a couple times. Overnight, we've been getting pounded with it. Have you been out in the flea market?
Yeah, I took a walk around between things this morning. It looked like a flea market, you know.
Was it getting muddy yet?
No, not for me. I just didn't walk in the mud.
You stayed out of the mud. There was some mud to be had.
Yep, but you don't walk in it. See, that's the thing. You don't walk in the mud, and you don't get muddy. So a pro tip for the Hamvention, don't walk in the mud.
Okay, you working on the handbook now?
Yes, the next handbook edition is always in labor at this point, and we're working hard on that, got a lot of changes, and then there'll be a new technician general extra class cycle starting next year, so lots of books.
You're still contract, right?
Yes, that's right. I'm independent. I have the brown badge here. Oh, I don't have it on. Yes, I have the brown badge. So that means loose cannon. That's right. So I'm not really staff.
All right. I'm trying to think of anything else, but my brain has just about gone flat here. Can you still think?
Yeah, apparently so. At least the mouth parts are still working. Yes. You know, it's come on out to Hamvention. If you haven't done it, you should do it once. Come out, see the biggest ham radio thing in the world, and it's just amazing. You'll find stuff that you never even thought you would ever need or want, but you got to take them home.
Yep. I really didn't know what to expect, and I would say this is better than expected. You were thinking the attendance is up from here last year. I would call that way better than expected. Hamfests, in my experience, that move from one place to another generally take a hit, but Dayton may be hit-proof.
Well, you know, I think if they'd have waited a year, it might have taken a real hit, and people would have just let it drift off their agenda. And, boy, they've really done a good job. I know it's been a heavy lift and hard work, and I really appreciate that. I know everything's not perfect, but from all reports, people are saying we have the right problems. You know, we have a lot of people to deal with, and, you know, we got new products and lots of people buying stuff and learning stuff and talking about stuff and old friends getting together. It's great.
Well, this move is not killing Hamvention, that is for sure.
Oh, no, it may have saved it.
Yeah, it may. Now, you do the spurious emission bands, that's tonight?
That's right, tonight at 10 o'clock, second floor of the Crown Plaza Presidential Ballroom. As soon as we can get our sound check done, they're back there right now, laboring over cables and all this kind of stuff, and I'm going to go back and, you know, flank around a little bit. It'll be fun.
All right, so I heard you guys on Neil Rapp's show on Ham Talk Live.
Yes, we did, and Neil gave us an idea for a song that we're going to do tonight.
Can you reveal any of that? Because this isn't live. People aren't going to see this until days or weeks after.
Well, let's just say it's a ham radio version of Wild Thing.
Okay, because I just wrote a song parody that I would like to get done, but it's a crooner. It's not a rock song.
Okay, well, you croon away and have fun.
I'll give you the first line. And I don't think you can do this because it pokes a little bit too much fun at something, but maybe you guys can get away with this. It is incompatible. That's what you are. D-star system fusion DMR. Why buy one HT? No, I screwed up my words. Something about buy three HTs instead of one so that you can talk to everyone. Which one will it be when you're calling me?
Well, see, what you do is...
I got it fleshed out.
You go get the karaoke version of the song, and then in the bathroom in the morning, you know, you let her rip, you know, and you get that great reverb, and you have fun with it, and things will start coming to you, and then you can't stop.
So I was wondering who I was going to get to say this to, and it turns out that I get to say it to you. You guys are really good musicians and terrible singers.
That's right. We are doing this for the Yucks. That's about it. You know,
you can get signed to a label, though, right?
Sean's okay, a label, but it wouldn't be a record label. we just kind of let her rip. We only practice once a year. None of us sing professionally or anything else for obvious reasons. And the whole thing, we put the lyrics up on the screen so you can laugh along with it. It's all about the laughs. Have fun, go home, have some pizza, whatever.
So would you do a ballad?
We have a ballad. We have a show tune tonight.
Nostalgia, enjoy your memories, they're not the same.
We are doing Pink Floyd, we're doing Gordon Lightfoot, we have 9 new tunes.
This guy over here, my cameraman who just finally showed up, I expect he's going to be there.
Oh yes, Marty's always out there, he's got his lighter up, you know, everything is good.
And I will not, because I got to edit and go to sleep.
Well, we'll give you some material to do that.
Okay, maybe next year.
All right, we'll see you.
I've heard rumors of music video.
Music, I don't know, you know, it's kind of funny. Every year we think, oh, this is the last. But then we get together and we have such a good time, we got to do it.
We got a good audience now, don't you?
Yep, we pay them well. Free to get in, $5 to get out.
That's what I heard. All right, thank you, Ward.
73s, everybody.
1950, I'll take a couple of these. KC1CWF multi-multi. Oh, that must be a typo. Let's get that checked out.
As you said, it's my stalker. Hold that mic up real close. Noisy. Yeah.
Yes, it is. I am your stalker, the guy who tracked you down in, Brownsburg, Indiana one day.
So, you know you're not going to get away with us without getting on TV here.
I see that.
Who are you, and why were you stalking me?
Well, Jerry, K8VGL, and I'm stalking you because I wanted a chance to shake your hand and meet you. You've been driving by my house now twice and within a few miles, and my rare opportunity to meet the great Gary Pierce.
Okay, so you were watching on APRS?
Yes, I was.
So you tracked me down, and we are going to go eat some bad food there at White Castle.
Now, your favorite, as I understand.
It's one of my favorites.
Yep, and I was on my way back from a Tapper conference. You were watching me on APRS. You were actually watching me on the way out, but missed my zoom through Indianapolis. So you caught me on the way back, took me to lunch, and now you have a tip that you're going to reluctantly share with the audience here about getting into the new venue for the Hamvention.
Well, maybe a lot of them have already discovered it, but I've already passed this to some of my friends that are coming tomorrow, and that is, unless you're here before 7 a.m. in the Xenia area, don't bother to try to come into fairgrounds. Use the remote parking lots, especially the one on lot 2 for the high school, which isn't very far from here. And it's a very quick bus trip to get in.
So your remote parking experience was good?
Very, very good. Worked perfect.
We brought you under the bus, and I understand you got to ride on a fair wagon for the last couple hundred feet?
Yeah, something like that. You get to ride the fair wagon, or you can walk it if
probably
you want to.
Probably have to pay for that during the fair.
No,
during the fair.
Oh, yeah, probably at the fair. They might charge 50 cents. Some fairs do, some don't.
Yeah. All right, so remote parking, they're going to keep making changes to the road coming in. They may be able to solve it, but on a two-lane road, I'm not sure what they can do.
I don't know either, other than find alternate ways and run two paths in or something. But this was the trial year. We all knew that there was going to be major things that popped up that they was going to have to find solutions to. And I got to give credit to the DARA group that had put this on. From having to change as fast as they did, I think they've done a fabulous job of getting things done and things working. I've heard a lot of people compliment. This is a good ham fest. So, you know, maybe they didn't have experience of Dayton before.
Do you have a particular high point of the new venue?
One of my high points is that I got to finally meet and talk to Dr. Tamitha Scove.
Aha.
That's the reason why I had to be here today, so I could catch her and do that. And of course,
so you're a propagation geek.
Yes, I am. Yes, I am. I enjoy the solar weather and all the things with it. But the rest of it has been walking around trying to find everybody I thought I knew, and I've met a lot of some people, and it's been different. The biggest thing is everything's spread in three or four buildings, so you have to know where to go, either map yourself from the maps early, or just do like I did, walk in the door and start going in one building, not the other.
Your history with the Hera Arena might be too old for you to actually recall, but I got lost in that place for years and years and years until I finally mentally figured it out.
Even Hera Arena and the big ballrooms, all interconnected, were a little bit rough for anybody who came occasionally to ever get used to. Yeah. I came enough, often enough, that I knew where to go and how to get there. Yes.
Yeah, and I think this will be more of a logical layout. You know, there's buildings, but they're all disconnected and discrete, and if you remember where something is, you're going to be able to find your way back.
Yes, I agree with that, it will be more logical. And the only thing is if on nice warm days, it is going to be warm because the buildings have the doors open. They don't have a choice. They can't get the people in and out if they don't.
Yes, I've been glistening all day.
That's all right. Us hams are able to handle all this inclement weather. It's good training for field day. You know, it's always hot on field day.
Yeah, and it's tradition for the hamvention.
That's right.
It's got to rain, and I think it's about to.
That's right.
Okay, thank you, Jerry. Good seeing you again.
It's good seeing you too, Gary, and always look forward to Ham Radio Now on the web pages and also Facebook and YouTube. So yep. keep all the good videos coming.
So we're here in the, I guess I want to call this Yaesu Hall, because they're putting every vendor, every big Japanese company in a separate hall. So Kenwood is number one, ICOM is two, and I guess Yaesu is three. And thus far, Yaesu and Kenwood are slacking. I took a walk through the Yaesu booth, and I walked up to a salesman, said, you know, what do you see? What's new? What's exciting? And he goes, well, actually, absolutely nothing. You know, I don't know what's going on with Yaesu and Kenwood, but they seem to be sleeping or something, because they're way behind the eight ball. But while we're in here, let's take a little bit of a walk around the number three hall. We have Tar Heel Antennas making their mobile antennas in this building. Stepper, Diamond Antennas, and then my favorite part as we come around here, and I'm really excited about this thing. It's going to fit really well in my backyard. Luso sells these new towers, 120 feet, 1950 a tower. And I know my mom is going to really like this thing. We got the 4.5-inch bearing to go in here. And KC1CWF is going to be loud. So, you know, I think this thing is going to really help me work some smoking DX. So this is a big magnet and magnetic loop, right?
Yes, this is the big one for 80 meters to 20 meters. And the other is the baby for 40 meters to 10 meters.
So do they come apart? How do they come? Do they in pieces or together as one big loop or separate?
It's possible to divide in four sections.
Okay.
Okay. And the other one in two sections. Mm-hmm.
And how does this, there's a capacitor, what's in the bottom?
The capacitor is in the top of the antenna.
Yeah.
And here there is a gamma match with the ATU, automatic tuning unit. You can tune the capacitor in the frequency that you use. Inside the box there is a motor cable, and you connect it to the ATU.
Yeah.
Type the frequency that you want to use, and after the ATU generate a signal and move the actuator and tuning the capacitor.
So can this be used just in the ham bands or at any frequency?
Any frequency is a continuous coverage from 3.5 to 14.5 megahertz.
So let's talk about the power, how much power we can use.
The power is 300 watts up to 7 megahertz, and 800 watts from 8 to 40.5 megahertz.
And what about that one?
The baby loop start 450 watts up to 21 megahertz after 1 kilowatts in the end and 10 meters.
Great. Thank you so much. We appreciate you coming by. And we think this is very cool. You don't see a big loop all the time at the show. Thank you.
So, Marty, did you notice what they call this? This is the MIDI loop.
The MIDI loop.
The one over there.
The mini loop.
Is the baby loop.
Baby loop.
Do you know what they didn't bring?
The big loop?
The maxi loop. Just wait. Next year. Maxi loop.
Next year. We are gonna get the maxi loop.
You know what you clean the maxi loop with?
What?
You guys know, you got the joke already, and I am not going to say it. He's only 15.
You're so mature. You flipping.
What I said was I really like doing this stuff with him because I like playing with somebody my own age.
Okay, well, we're back at the Elad booth, and they are a maker of some really cool SDRs, software-defined radios, that is. And this year they're showing off all their parts and pieces of their famous Duo, SDR Duo transmitter. So we have the Duo, but then we also have the companion amplifier that they brought out this year. This is brand new, and it's also super cool. So it's a 60-watt amplifier, and inside the amplifier is also a docking station. So you can see spectrum displays and other really cool features on the amplifier display. Moving on from that, they also brought out a very cool touchscreen interface in which you can not only control the radio, but also interact with it remotely over a LAN. So if you have a wired connection, you can remote it. It's very cool stuff. They also have their receivers line. While Elad is known as a transmitting company, they also make receivers. And this year they have some on display. They have their famous S3 receiver, which is a special receiver and something actually we haven't seen from any other SDR maker on the market, which is a USB 3 SDR, which takes advantage of USB 3 technology. So there's a lot of throughput, something that a lot of other radio manufacturers don't have. Obviously, I think a company like Flex might make a better receiver. This one is certainly cool. They have their S2 as well here.
We'll have to test and find out. It's not ICOM and Flex are the only people making SDRs.
No.
And these guys are making them too. And this is made in Italy.
Interesting. Made in Italy.
They would be a part of this interview, but they're
too
not
scared
so sure
to come
about
on
their English.
Yeah. We really appreciate they've been very kind.
Their English is better than our Italian.
Their English is vastly superior than our Italian. But wait, as we're heading out of here, there's more. There's one more thing. I don't know. I never really thought about radios as something that you make pretty or cool. I mean, yes, a lot of the Japanese radios are nice, but we don't really think about them as art pieces. But I think Elad is changing that. They have two kind of fancy radios. They have their camo, too, and they also have their red radio. And I'm noting it's not just painted on there. The red finish is like anodized aluminum, and it's very nice. And this camo also seems intriguing. You know, to be honest, I've never seen anybody in the U.S. use any one of these for Sirius Radio, but I'd be intrigued to learn more about them.
But thank you, guys.
Thank you so much.
And
I'm tired.
Consider another world of SDR.
Yeah, I'm tired.
You want to go home?
I'm sweaty.
Yeah, and it's raining.
Friday is over.
And we're 60 miles from Dayton.
Let's go home.
We have half a pack of cigarettes, a full tank of gas, and we're wearing sunglasses.
Let's go, baby.
All right. This is Ham Radio Now.
And the Phasing Line.
I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and the Phasing Line Podcast.
I'm Marty KC1, CWF. Over.
From Xenia, Ohio.
Over.
And out.
Adios. Ciao.
And ciao.
Bye-bye now.
Which just makes me want dinner.
We want dinner now.